Is it not going to us?
Here we are.
Now, hopefully you can hear us and you can see us now as I was flustered and being like, why is it not going to the other thing?
Yeah.
Hello, everybody. How are you doing? Welcome to our monthly live stream.
So good to have you. I've just noticed I have a big thingy on my mic. That for a reason.
I had that on the other night. We could probably take that off, but then
we'll
it would all
later.
Go
it's okay.
And everybody's listening.
How is everyone?
How are you doing? Give us a comment. Let us know how you're doing. There's been a few people here have been commenting away. Yeah. We have Arne, who's been commenting from over there in Fermanagh. Paul from the whole way down in County Cork. And Iris from literally
around
just around the corner from us here.
So we're all over the place tonight.
All
and
over.
Arne, you said Arne from what?
Yeah. And there's Francisco coming from Ballymena. Good to have you on tonight, Francisco. Everybody else, give us a wee comment there if you're listening along. And now is as good a time as any to hit share. Have you shared it yet?
No, I haven't.
Well,
I need to share.
Now's the time.
Let's get our phones out.
Let's all do it together.
Let's hit share. It really does help to get the word out as far as possible and to as broad a range of people as possible, because so many people let us know after a live stream that they tuned in because somebody shared it, isn't it?
Yeah.
And especially over the Easter weekend there, we noticed a lot of people were coming saying that their friends were watching or that they noticed someone was tuned in because they had shared it. So please share it. We want to get the good news out as far and as wide as possible. So
yeah, hit share, and you could maybe even do what I just done and tag somebody.
Ooh.
Because I just decided I should probably tag the couple of folk that are taking part tonight.
Not a good
idea.
Yeah.
So I just tagged Gavin Harrison. And if you have been following along here at FM Transition, you may have or you may remember Rebecca Harrison, mm-hmm. who has been singing for us. She done a poem for us.
Mm-hmm.
That was back at camp. Online at the camp weekend. Then she was singing over the Bangor weekend with us here as well.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is her husband, Gavin. And it's so good to have Gavin on. And you've seen Rebecca loads of times. And Gavin has been the one that's been behind the camera and doing all the stuff there. So tonight we have got him in front of the camera.
Yes.
And he's going to share a message with us tonight. So you're going to have to stay tuned for that.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have Timmy Farmer, who has come along to help us with some worship tonight. We're just so glad to have Timmy.
Yeah.
He came last week, and I've known Timmy for a long time. You're going to hear a little bit more about that as well, because I kind of just put him on the spot when he was here. Sure, why not?
Yeah.
You know, you have to keep people on their toes, don't
yeah.
you? And so
they might not come back, but
no, he said he would come back.
Oh,
he said he would come back. But I've known Timmy for a while. Timmy is the pastor, the leader of the worship team, and all of us guys over at church. I'm part of the team, and I've known Timmy for a long time. And so we were chatting about tacky stuff one night, and I said, sure, come over to see what we have here, what we're working with. And then I said, bring your guitar and we'll record a few songs. And what happened was, we didn't have a plan. That doesn't surprise you. But we didn't have a plan. And Timmy often sings, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for loving me. And you know that I absolutely love that chorus song, whatever that falls into. So I says, we'll start there and then let's see what happens. We ended up singing for like 47 minutes. So we're not going to play all 47 minutes tonight. So please just stay tuned.
Keep
in.
It in the bank.
We're going to have it there.
Mm-hmm.
And what I was actually thinking when I was listening through it earlier was maybe we could post the whole thing maybe on YouTube or something.
Yeah.
If you want, just like a, you know, make a cup of coffee and just stick it on the TV or on your laptop.
Or have it on the background with the wains. I do that sometimes.
Yeah, just some music
going.
There.
Yeah.
Or maybe you want to just sit down and just relax and just worship along. Maybe you want to read along with it. I was thinking I must say to Timmy and see if he's okay. There's a couple of wee bits where it was a bit dodgy. We were just going with it.
But that's okay.
But we could put it up and it would just be really natural.
Oh, yeah.
So
yeah,
if you'd be interested in that, give us a shout there.
Mm-hmm.
Give us a like or a comment. And we would love to hear from you if you would be interested in something like that there.
Yeah.
So What else have we to talk about tonight, Amy?
Do you know what I have to talk about?
Go on ahead.
My hair appointment tomorrow.
Oh, dear. Oh.
Yay.
Dear. Oh.
Me and our eldest daughter, Hannah, who is going to be 3 next week, are both booked in for a hair appointment tomorrow. I can't wait. Haven't got it cut since before Christmas. So we're very excited. Leave us a comment if you have got your hair cut or if you are planning on getting your hair cut. We are very excited here in Castle Dawson.
Maybe just went the same route as me and went for the old COVID haircut.
Yeah, well,
I am not going back.
I'm not going for a COVID haircut.
sorry to the barber, but you've lost your like 8 quid a month off me. Mm-hmm. This is the way it's going to be from now on. It's hard to beat.
Just I don't mind it.
Give her a wee
it was
cut,
a bit of a shock
jump in
at the
shower.
Start, but you know.
My shock was how far back the hairline was.
Oh,
that
that's
the fringe
true.
Was hiding a whole lot
I'm
of
not
stuff
even
there.
Lie. That's the strong thing there. But yes, leave us a comment if you're excited about getting your hair cut. It's been a long time, hasn't it?
It has been a long time.
Yeah.
It has been a long time. I've been
and
listening about this for a long time.
And the shops are opening on Friday too.
That's so right.
That's even more good news.
So
it's going to be fun.
It's really good that things are starting to open up a wee
yeah.
bit. And let us know if you've been out and about anywhere or what you've been at. Mm-hmm. We're out. I'm out on Friday night at a drive-in. I was out more this past weekend than I possibly have been all year put together. I was out a few different places, got a few miles racked up in the car. Mm-hmm. We haven't been driving about the same as we normally have been. And so we were out and about there just last weekend. And it was good to be out. Done a couple of drive-ins, one way down for George Conn there and on Thursday night. And then I was outside Dungannon at Gortmern for their drive-in Sunday night. I was in Banbridge, Banbridge on Sunday night. And then on Friday, we're heading over to Sing Me and Heavenly Sunshine at the drive-in in Ballymena. So if you're knocking about Ballymena, it's on all week. So you could call over any night, but we'll be there to sing on Friday night, and we're really looking forward to it because the gospel truck's going to be there.
Da, da, da. If you haven't heard about the gospel truck, it is the latest ministry to enter the faith mission. It mm-hmm. is literally a lorry that converts into a cafe or a cinema screen or it's loads of
yeah,
different
Yeah, we probably should have put a picture of it up, shouldn't
yeah,
we?
Yeah, but go on
you'll
to
have
the
to go
Faith
Friday
Mission
night
website.
And see it.
Yes. Go yeah. on to the Faith Mission website. They have a Facebook page which shows you all their
Faith Mission
so.
Gospel Truck. If you search that here on Facebook, it'll take you to the Facebook page and you can see some of the pictures there.
Yeah.
It's a fantastic job. I'm really looking forward to seeing it. In the flesh.
I want to go over and see it in the flesh.
It's really good. So a big shout out to Andrew Mabin, who has carried the weight of that and so many others who have had input into that. And we just trust and pray that over the summer it's going to be used. And not just the summer, but further ahead. It's booked all
it's
out.
It's booked to September or something.
We trust that God's just going to do amazing things through it. And just to facilitate so many people hearing the word, so many people maybe even coming to know Jesus for the first time.
We could maybe use it for a wee FM transition night sometime.
That would
or
be good. That would be good if we could get the use of the truck at some stage. So we're heading over there on Friday night. And then on Sunday, we're heading down to Caledon again.
Yeah.
Haven't been there in ages.
I know.
And we've missed the folk down there.
Emily has never been to Caledon.
Not
Emily
enough.
Has only been to church like twice so far in her life.
So we're not bad terrible. Parents. We were watching online.
I know. if you were saying that like a year and a half ago, you would
never
be shocked.
It.
You'd be like, "Why have you not been to church in a year?" But yeah, so we're really looking forward to going to Caledon because we really enjoy Caledon.
Yeah, we love going down to
church
to Caledon. We've missed being down.
Yeah.
So hopefully you have got out and about to some drive-ins. Maybe your church has opened up again in person and you've been fit to get out and to meet some of your brothers and sisters in Christ and just to fellowship together, to sing together and just to worship together. It's been great to start and get out and about a bit. And we've got a bit used maybe sitting in, haven't we?
Really used.
Really like, used.
We're not used to juggling 2 children and going out and about. So we're not. No, we've never had to do it. So it's a whole. It's like having like a first, like second child enter a game because you're like, oh,
all,
what do we
all
do?
New. So really good to have so many of you tuning in there tonight. There's Alicia's commenting from
Alicia.
Scotland and saying hello to us from Scotland. Great to have you on, Alicia. And give it a wee share just as we're getting ready to head into tonight's meeting, into the main content for tonight. Now is a great time, if you haven't done so already, to give it a wee share. And who knows who might tune in tonight from you sharing.
Paul Slater says, I always get my hair cut at home. That's good. Just the way you are like now.
That's the way to go. Yeah. I'm loving it. Yeah. I'm loving it.
Why waste your time going to... I wouldn't trust Johnny with scissors. That's the only thing.
Or your special shampoo.
I used my special shampoo the other day and Hannah was mesmerized that a white shampoo can turn my hair brown from gray. So
such sorcery.
Amazing. Amazing.
So give the stream here, the live, a wee share, and Amy's going to pray for us, and then we'll maybe just bounce straight into the content tonight. We're going to just go into the interview with Timmy, then some worship, and then the message from Gavin, and then myself and Timmy will come back at the end for a wee song or two as well before we finish up for tonight. So that's what's ahead for tonight. So Amy, would you pray for us just before we go into that?
So Father, thank you for all your goodness to us over this past month since we were last on our live stream. God, we thank you for your protection over us. We thank you for your goodness in our lives and the many blessings that you have poured out upon us. And we thank you that we can come together again tonight through this technology. Father, we thank you that you have used people to spread your word. And we thank you for Timmy and for Gavin and for their skills and the talents that they are willing to share with us tonight. And we pray that your spirit will be at work in each life listening in this hour or so that we're together. God, we pray that lives will be changed and that they will feel your spirit close to them. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. And just when it's in my head there, I always forget to say it. But if you're watching on the replay, it's great to have you along too. Sometimes you can't make these things live and then you pick them up later. We want to know that we really appreciate you tuning in and watching along as well. It's great to have you with us. So without further ado, let's just jump into the main segment for tonight. Hey everybody, welcome along to FM Transition tonight. It's great to have you all listening along. And it's great to have Timmy Farmer with us here tonight. And myself and Timmy have just been recording a few songs. Although when you're watching this, you've probably heard a few of them already. But we've been singing for, what, about 45 minutes?
Yeah, just going for it.
We've just been enjoying ourselves. Don't tune out of the live stream. We're not going to play all 45 minutes. It's grand. But I thought I would just ask Timmy a couple of questions here, just on the spot. We've been singing about God's faithfulness, about God's goodness. And I just wanted Timmy to share just a little bit of what God has done in his life. We've known each other quite a while, Timmy, haven't we?
Yeah.
Back in the good old J.C. Stewart's days.
J.C. Stewart.
Do you remember that? If you're not from around the Mid-Ulster area, you probably haven't a clue what we're talking about. But if you're local, you may well know J.C. Stewart's was a supermarket in Macclesfield. Mm-hmm. And myself and Timmy used to work there back in the day.
Well, if you could call it that, yeah.
Well, we clocked in.
Yeah, you clocked in.
Look,
that was part of the problem.
Everybody was jealous of my job. Yeah. I used to be the trolley pusher out in the car park, and I had a great time and let the rest of you do the work.
I'd probably give off to you a right bit too.
Sure, it was all right. Yeah. But I'll tell you a story of how I then got reconnected with Timmy. Mm-hmm. So I went off to Faith Mission Bible College. And if you want to know more about it, give us a shout. Mm-hmm. And that was 2008 to 2010. I disappeared. I came back and I heard about this new church that had started and everybody was talking about it and not a lot of people had been. And I decided I was going to go. When I knew Timmy at J.C. Stewart's, we would have been out at the back. Timmy had an addiction to cigarettes and Diet Coke.
Yeah.
And that was the way things were back then. Mm-hmm. And I went to this church and the worship team came out from backstage and who was singing and playing guitar but Timmy. I couldn't believe it.
Wow.
I couldn't believe it. And that's one of my clear memories from going to church the first day. I remember Al McComb spotting me, saying hello and saying, "You've never been here before." And I was like, out of 400 people, how do you know I have never been here before? And I remember you singing and playing that Sunday. And so now Timmy's my pastor.
Wow.
Well, you don't have the pastor. Well, do they call you Pastor Timmy yet?
I kind of, no, not really.
Not really.
Not really officially, no.
But Timmy leads the worship team and the media guys at our church, and I'm part of the team. Mm-hmm. And so I see Timmy often. But just share a wee bit, just of your story, just a little bit of the goodness and the faithfulness of God.
Well, I think the very dramatic thing, change that was made in those years where you went to Bible college and then came back and saw a completely different guy was obviously the Lord had really entered my life. And I was probably at that stage when you knew me before, like I was a very broken guy. I'd been through a lot of things in my childhood. I'd been through a lot of sort of messy stuff within churches and stuff like that. And so it definitely pushed me as far away from God as I could possibly be.
Yeah.
It pushed me as far away from church as I could possibly be. But there was one thing that always lingered on, and it's that whenever I listened to worship music, I knew that something was different.
Yeah.
I could feel, it was obviously the Spirit of God moving in me.
Yeah, yeah.
But even in those years where I was partying and living that life and going down that path, there was always something that happened when I heard someone lead worship or I heard like Hillsong or Vineyard or something that just happened. Even though I didn't like to admit it, I knew that something was different. So it started off like this. I was working in JC's church at the time and going to uni, and I started going to a church, right?
Okay.
And I went, and it's a well-known church, similar probably to Green Pastures. But I went there for about 2 years, and I sat in the back row, and I purposely didn't connect with anyone, and I just went to listen to the worship. And I went, I was maybe out on a Friday night, out on a Saturday night, and stumbling in on a Sunday morning, but I went because I knew that when I sat in that room and they started to sing worship unto God, that the presence of God was there and it was doing something. I felt something, physically felt something.
That's
so
amazing.
Right, long story short, and a massive amazing thing happened obviously in that, look, eventually Paul Stewart, my boss in JC's church, sort of took an interest in me and decided that he would help me out a wee bit and invited me along to a small group.
Okay.
Within that church, which you probably know what it is now. And I started going to that small group. And within that small group, like, he knew I was interested in music a bit, had learned to play the guitar a bit when I was a bit younger. And he invited me along one night to come and bring the guitar and we'll do a few songs.
Okay.
And that kind of was my entry into leading worship, was in via a wee small group and via... Just a guy that look, I thank God for him because he saw something in me and he decided to invest in me and he invited me to that.
Yeah.
And he didn't have to because like he saw me smoking out the back and he knew that it wasn't really where I was at.
Yeah.
But through that I got connected into that group, got connected into church and gave my life to God and realized that wow, there's such a purpose for my life and it is within worship and that thing that's inside of me that caused me to feel and caused a move in me, a shift in me, even whenever I was far away from God, is that thing now that I am so free and I love and I want to. So that story of you, I didn't know that you came
Did
to
you
church
not?
Now. And I actually love that because like wow, like how good's God, like that you would be surprised to see me up there.
And I'm still there 11 years later.
And you're still there. Aye. And we're here now.
Here there's a couple of things that we need to just highlight again here. Maybe you're listening along online and maybe you don't know God. Maybe you've never gave your life to Jesus. Maybe you're questioning, maybe you've got doubts, maybe you're just a bit skeptical. That's fine.
Yeah.
And maybe you're tuning in, listening to this because there's just something.
Yeah.
There's just something that's pulling you along.
Yeah.
Can we encourage you to keep like pushing in?
Yeah.
To keep tuning in. We love having you along.
Yeah.
Keep asking questions. Mm. Keep searching. Mm. Get the Bible out and read it.
Yeah.
Get a playlist on Spotify or go onto YouTube and search something and listen to it and ask God to show himself to you. Just
Very good.
Be brave enough.
Yeah.
to say, God, I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But I believe there's something, God, I want you
to
highlight it to me, or to bring the right people across my path.
Yeah.
And we'll mention Paul again, because Paul, if any of you have known me long enough to be about at my first album launch, which was way back in 2014, Paul weighed in, and he had, again, no need to, but Paul jumped in and made that launch just something special because he knew people.
Yeah.
And I was actually thinking about it the other day. He, like, he arrived with, like, wee champagne glasses and a few cases of Schlur just for the people who were coming to the launch night. Yeah. And he just made it something so much more. And I was thinking about it the other day, actually. Yeah. And so maybe you know somebody that that you could just invite along to a small group.
Yeah.
Or somebody that you could send a message to encourage. Or maybe you know somebody that knows a few chords and a guitar, and you could invite them maybe to come and share a song.
Yeah.
Or maybe you're an employer and there's maybe somebody who's in your staff.
Wow.
And could you just do something?
Mm-hmm.
Anything? Mm-hmm. Could you just, like Timmy said, take an interest.
Yeah.
Ask them how they're doing.
Yeah.
See if there's something you can do.
Yeah.
And you could be a link in the chain to change in somebody's life. Mm-hmm. Like, did Paul know when he was going to invite you along to a small group that you would now be staff on the church? Like,
probably not.
Not
a clue. And
you don't know. You don't know the impact that you could have on someone just by a random act of kindness or just by inviting them along, being a smiling face, by just noticing somebody. We live in a world where we're more connected, yet more disconnected than ever.
Totally.
And so to even just notice somebody
might
be the push, that the encouragement that they need. One more wee question.
Okay.
You love old hymns.
Yeah.
And choruses. Mm-hmm. That's something that me and Timmy talk about often. We love the new stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, stick on a good boppy song you know, well, Timmy could jump more than me because I get out of puff. But we love the new songs. And God tells us over and over, we're to sing a new song unto the Lord. But there's something about an old song too, isn't there?
Totally.
What's your favorite hymn, or is there a reason why you love old songs?
Well, first of all, I would say that I grew up in church, but wouldn't have been very familiar with hymns.
Yeah.
So it's not even that they take me back to a place where I was back when I was younger, and that's the thing that pulls me back. I actually would say a lot of old hymns are new to me.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
And there's something about the way a hymn is written that cuts through all of the noise. There's just something, and I've even seen it. Look, I've seen it leading worship. I've been leading worship now for a good few years, and there's just something that a hymn will do to break the room. There's something that a hymn will do to just, no matter what's going on, it'll pull people in.
Yeah.
And
there's a reason it has stood the test
of
time, isn't it?
There's a reason, and it's almost this purity in it that they're very real, they're very raw, and you can almost think back to the stories. If you hear some of the stories behind how some of them were written, like the times that people were living in, where faith was like simple faith, and it was like life or death stuff.
They were trusting God for daily bread.
And how like it. Even nowadays, some of the songs that we're writing now can be about, like, can almost be about us and not about him.
Yeah.
You know? And I'm very much trying to, even when I'm trying to write songs, when we're trying to do that, is to make them about Jesus. And learn from those things, and learn from hymns, and learn from, like, sing the Word of God. Like, honestly, that's not going to go, you're not going to go wrong with singing the Word of God.
I think all of those hymns that stand, not all of them, but a lot of them that stand the test of time, have our need of Jesus in some way. So my favorite hymn for sure is "I Stand Amazed in the Presence."
Very good.
My favorite by far.
Yeah.
So "I Stand Amazed in the Presence of Jesus," and then I wonder how he could love me.
Yes.
So a sinner condemned, unclean. It highlights our need.
Yeah.
Verse 3, he took my sins and my sorrow, takes us to the cross. And then it always leads us back to Jesus is coming back again, and probably sooner than we think.
Yeah.
When you look around, And I love that last verse, when with the ransom and glory, his face I at last shall see. Like, how that's amazing.
Yeah.
And the modern songs. So if you're listening to this and like, you know, 50 years in the future and you've stumbled across this, here's my thought.
Yeah.
I think the modern songs that'll stand the test of time have the same things.
Yeah.
So 10,000 Reasons.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
They, you know, they tick us through that, you know, what God has done.
Yeah.
You know, I can't just think of the lyric the minute of the second verse, but it definitely brings us to like the cross and, you know, 10,000 reasons for my heart to sing.
Yeah.
And then it takes us to heaven.
Yeah.
Where we've got all of eternity.
Yeah.
And praise the name's another one.
Brilliant.
You know, I cast my mind to Calvary where Jesus bled and died for me. And it takes us
that to me is a modern gospel, hymn though. That to me is a modern hymn. And that's what I feel that the challenge is now for us to write.
It's hard.
Totally is hard. But simple melody, simple truth, word of God stuff.
Yeah, like, and that's congregational friendly.
Totally, because it still has to relate. Like, it still has to pull people in, and still has to catch. You know.
So if you're listening along and you've got a wee notebook full of ideas,
yeah. Send
keep
them going. To us.
Keep writing and give us a shout. We would love to try them.
Yeah.
What's your favorite hymn? Do you have one?
I would say possibly the Old Rugged Cross. Just that idea of laying down all of my own stuff and how, even thinking back to when that was written, what that looked like for the hymn writer.
Yeah.
Like my trophies at last I lay down. Like,
what a line.
What a line. And thinking that's even class. About the trophies in my life and the things that I make it. And that simple truth is where it's at.
That's a good one.
I think love that's my favorite. Yeah.
Well, here, Timmy, thanks so much for coming and sharing today. Timmy's been here way longer than he anticipated because we got talking about all sorts.
Yeah.
And then when we got playing and singing, that went longer. Yeah. And then I was like, here, do a wee interview for us before you go. So, Timmy, thanks for coming.
No problem.
And sharing. My pleasure. And singing and playing. And brilliant. Sure, we'll maybe have you on again sometime.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it, John.
So, I don't know. We'll cut to whatever's coming next in the program.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for loving me. Thank you, Jesus. Up from
rejoice, and all the earth rejoice, and he wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice, and how great is our
God, you
for from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
I wonder if you've ever had the questions going through your mind of, how do I know that God is real? How do I know that he is there? How do I know if the God that Christians believe in, how do I know if he's the true God or not? How do I know if there's only one true God? These are all different questions that I'm sure some of us have had. I want you to imagine this evening that you're heading into battle. You're walking up to the battle line. And you look to your right and you look to your left, and you realize that you're the only person there. And as you look in front of you, you see a vast army, about 400 or 500 people in front of you. And if you watch movies, you'll have seen this from time to time. You'll have seen that there's one good guy or one good person, and then there's this army or this group of people opposing them round about them. And if you were to look at this situation, you'd probably say that the odds are somewhere round about 450-1. The odds are against the one person. If you'd like to follow along, if you have a Bible, we're going to read from 1 Kings chapter 18, and we'll begin reading at verse 20. Up until this point in 1 Kings, if you were to look back at chapter 16, verse 29, we see that Ahab now begins to rule in Israel. And Ahab continues in the pattern that the rulers have done before him. They have done evil in the sight of God. But Ahab here, he goes a little bit further than those that have gone before him. We see in verse 30 of chapter 16 that it says, "And Ahab, the son of Omri, did evil in the sight of the Lord, more than all who were before him." King Ahab is refusing to follow God, the one who created everything and the one who holds everything together. At this point in Kings, we see that Ahab and his wife Jezebel follow Baal. They worship this god called Baal, and they've made an idol or an altar to Baal, and they begin worshipping it. In doing all of this, we read on of how Jezebel and Ahab then, how they get rid of all of God's prophets. Hope seems gone for the Israelites, and God's name seems to be eradicated or wiped out from Israel completely. And that's where we pick up our reading from in 1 Kings chapter 18 and reading at verse 20. "So Ahab summoned all the people of Israel and the prophets to Mount Carmel. Then Elijah stood in front of them and said, 'How much longer will you waver, hobbling between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal is God, then follow him.' But the people were completely silent. Then Elijah said to them, 'I am the only prophet of the Lord who is left, but Baal has 450 prophets. Now bring two bulls. The prophets of Baal may choose whichever one they wish, and cut it into pieces and lay it on the wood of their altar, but without setting fire to it. I will prepare the other bull and lay it on the wood on the altar, but not set fire to it. Then call on the name of your God, and I will call on the name of the Lord. The God who answers by setting fire to the wood is the true God.' And all the people agreed. Then Elijah said to the prophets of Baal, 'You go first, because there's many of you. Choose one of the bulls and prepare it, and call on the name of your God, but do not set fire to the wood.' So they prepared one of the bulls and placed it on the altar. Then they called on the name of Baal from morning until noontime, shouting, 'O Baal, answer us!' But there was no reply of any kind. Then they danced, hobbling around the altar they had made. About noontime, Elijah began mocking them. 'You'll have to shout louder,' he scoffed, 'for surely he is a god. Perhaps he's daydreaming, or perhaps he's relieving himself, or maybe he's away on a trip, or is asleep and needs to be wakened.' So they shouted louder and followed their normal custom. They cut themselves with knives and swords until blood gushed out. They raved all afternoon until the time of the evening sacrifice. But still there was no sound, no reply, and no response. Then Elijah called the people, "Come over here." They all crowded around him as he repaired the altar of the Lord that had been torn down. He took 12 stones, one to represent each of the 12 tribes of Israel, and he used the stones to rebuild the altar in the name of the Lord. Then he dug a trench around the altar, large enough to hold about 3 gallons. He piled wood on the altar, cut the bull into pieces, and laid the pieces on the wood. Then he said, "Fill 4 large jars with water, and pour the water over the offering and the wood." After they had done this, he said, "Do the same thing again." And when they were finished, he said, "Now do it a third time." So they did as he said, and the water ran around the altar and even filled the trench. At the usual time of offering the evening sacrifice, Elijah the prophet walked up to the altar and prayed, "O Lord, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, prove today that you are God in Israel and that I am your servant. Prove that I have done all this at your command. O Lord, answer me. Answer me so that these people will know that you, O Lord, are God and that you have brought them back to yourself." Immediately, the fire of the Lord flashed down from heaven and burned up the young bull, the wool, the wood, the stones, and the dust. It even licked up all the water in the trench. And when all the people saw it, they fell face down on the ground and cried out, "The Lord, he is God. Yes, the Lord is God." Like I started off by asking, have you had any questions in your mind of, is God real? Does God really exist? If he does exist, is he the only God? Is he the true and living God? Maybe you're listening in this evening and if you've had questions like that running through your mind, maybe you have even those questions running through your mind as you sit and listen this evening. Have you ever had the thought of having a contest to see who is the true God? That's exactly what happens here in what we read tonight. Elijah is challenging the prophets of Baal to a contest, a competition to prove once and for all who is the true and living God. Remember the odds of this battle? Elijah is one man, and our passage tells us that there are about 450 prophets of Baal. The crowds are looking on, the people of Israel are there, they're looking on, and they're wondering what is going to happen. They're wanting to find out who is the true God. The scene is set. Elijah tells the prophets of Baal that they will each build an altar, they'll sacrifice the bull, but they will not set fire to it. And whoever's God is the true God will consume the offering. You see, at this point in time, at this point in history, the way that people's sin was dealt with, all the wrong that they had done, the way that it was dealt with was by offering a sacrifice. Something, an animal, would have to die in their place in order to buy them forgiveness. But this was a process that had to happen over and over and over again. It wasn't just a one-time thing and that was it for the rest of their lives. So what we read tonight, Elijah is saying, whoever's God accepts this offering is the true and living God. He says that if Baal is the true God, then worship Baal. But if God, the God of the Bible, is the true God, then we should be worshipping him. And Elijah was gracious in a way, and he allowed the prophets of Baal to go first because there were so many of them. So on one side, you have the prophets of Baal. They're setting up their altar. They sacrifice this animal and they put it on the altar that they had made. And then they began calling on their god, Baal. And they called and they called. And it says that they called on the name of Baal from morning until noontime, shouting, "O Baal, answer us." But there was no reply of any kind. Then they danced and hobbled around their altar that they had made. Baal was not answering them. There was no sound, nothing coming from their god called Baal. And Elijah begins to mock them. He shouts, he says, "You need to shout louder. He's maybe in a daydream. He can't hear you. Or maybe he's relieving himself. He's gone to the toilet. Maybe he's on holiday, or maybe he's asleep." This goes on for a while. and nothing seems to be working for the prophets of Baal. And on the other side, we have Elijah. Elijah builds his altar, sacrifices his animal, places his animal on the altar, but he goes a step further. He digs this trench around the altar, and he has the people cover it with 12 large jugs of water. Now, have you ever tried to set fire to damp wood or wet wood? I remember we would have a fire at home, and there'd always be a bit of wood lying in it from the year before, and it was always damp, it was always wet, and no matter how hard you tried, the damp or wet wood would never light. And here Elijah is that confident in God that he douses everything in water, and Elijah doesn't even touch, so to speak, a box of matches. And verse 36 says, Elijah the prophet walks up to the altar and prays, O Lord, God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, prove today that you are God in Israel and that I am your servant. Prove that I have done all this at your command. O Lord, answer me, so that these people will know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you have brought them back to yourself. And what happened? In verse 38 tells us, immediately the fire of the Lord flashed down from heaven and burnt up the young bull, the wood, the stones, and the dust. It even licked up all the water in the trench. Here we have God, the God of the Bible, defying the odds. 450 prophets of Baal, and one on one side, and we have Elijah, one man, one person, on the other side. Odds of 450-1. The difference being is that Baal was a false god. But Elijah's God was and is, even today, the true and living God. And that's the main point of this passage. And it says in verse 37, O Lord, answer me. Answer me so that these people will know that you, O Lord, are God. I hope that as you listen this evening, that you're able to see that the God of the Bible, the God of Elijah, my God, and is the true and living God. He's the one who made all things. He's the one who holds all things together. He's the one who knows everything about us. He is the one who is worth following. But why or how do we follow God? You see, this thing of sacrifice that I talked a little bit about before began in the Old Testament, where these animals were sacrificed in order to pay the price for sin for the people. However, that one sacrifice wasn't enough to take away, or wasn't enough to forgive sins for all time. The people had to keep coming back and keep offering another animal. But by the time we get to the New Testament, we see that God himself is providing the sacrifice. But this sacrifice is different. This isn't an animal, but it is God's one and only Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus came into this world as a sacrifice in order to die in your place and mine, to buy us forgiveness, to deal with our sins. Jesus was betrayed. He was handed over to be crucified for our forgiveness. Our sin, it separates us from God. And when we leave this scene of time, when we leave earth as we know it, we are heading to an eternal destination. And it's here, at this point, that the difference is made. If we leave this scene of time without God, we're told we're heading to an eternity of separation from God, where there's pain, turmoil, all manner of different things that the Bible talks about. But when we come to God, and when we ask for his forgiveness, because of what Jesus has done, nothing that we can do, it's nothing that we can do for ourselves, because of the sacrifice that he has made, in dying on the cross and rising again, our eternal destination can be changed. We are no longer separated from God, but we are part of God's eternal family. We are known as children of King Jesus. We are co-heirs with Christ. As I finish, I want to make three points this evening. Number one, what is number one in your life? What's number one in my life? Is God number one? or is something else in that prime or in that pole position? Something else is number one in your life. It's like Baal. It's like a false god. It shouldn't be there. It's an idol, and these idols need to be pulled down and put out. But how do we do that? How do we get rid of these idols? It all starts from a living relationship with God. It's about spending time with God on a regular basis. As a hymn puts it like this, it says, "Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace." When we spend time with Jesus, when we put him first in our lives, then we want to glorify him in everything we do, because we know who we are in Christ. So that's the first point. God should be number one in our lives. Number two, point two. And maybe you're sitting this evening and you're listening along to this. And maybe somebody shared it and you just happen to be listening along. Maybe you're not a Christian this evening. Maybe you don't trust in this God that I've been talking about. Maybe you don't trust in the God of the Bible. I hope and I trust that each of us who've been listening along tonight can see that the God of the Bible, Elijah's God, is the true and living God. That's what this story is all about. That you, O Lord, are God. Jesus came into this world for you and for me, that we might know him and that we might know our sins forgiven, that we can be friends with God, that we can know our eternal destination is sure and certain. If you don't know God today, and maybe you want to know more, maybe you want to find out more, why not send Johnny and Amy a little message, and they'll be happy to talk to you and happy to share if you want to find out more answers. But I ask you, if you're wanting to find out more, don't let it go by. Don't forget about it. Seek out the answers that you're looking for. Point three then. When things seem impossible, God is in control. God can take a situation, no matter how big it feels to us, and completely overrule. I think the story of Elijah, the odds are 450-1. But God took this situation. The situation was in favour of the prophets of Baal. But God took this situation and he worked it out for his good and for his glory. God is in control of every situation in our lives. You know, like I've said the whole way through this, the odds of this battle were completely in favour of the prophets of Baal from a human point of view. But here in this story, we see that the people who are watching on, the people who are in Israel, looking on at this situation taking place, we see that finally they see that God, the God of Elijah, the God of the Bible, is the true and living God. Verse 39 says, "And when all the people saw it, they fell face down on the ground and cried out, 'The Lord, he is God. Yes, the Lord is God.'" Do you know this evening? That the Lord is God? Hopefully some of those questions that you had at the beginning, like, is God real? Does God really exist? If he does exist, is he the only one? Are there not other gods? Is he the true and living God? I hope from this little story of Elijah that you see that the God of the Bible is the true and living God. The God of the Bible that I've been speaking about tonight, he is the only one that can save us from our sins. He's the only one that can give us an eternal hope and an eternal future. God is alive. He's interested in your life. He's interested in my life. And if you don't know Jesus, I just ask that you'd reach out to Johnny and Amy, send them a message, ask them what it's all about, seek out who Jesus is, and trust him and find him as your savior today. Thank you for listening.
Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take am at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him. Trust Him more. No, for grace to trust Him more. We trust You. We trust You. Your ways are higher than our own. And we trust You. We trust You, and Your ways are higher than our own. We trust You, God. Oh, we trust You, and we trust You. Your ways are higher than our own. We trust You, God. Oh, we trust You in all things. We trust You. Oh,
we're back.
Hello.
We hope you really enjoyed that tonight. I really enjoyed that myself.
I did too. I love those songs at the end, especially. They're some of my
those songs
ones.
Were not, we didn't know what Gavin was speaking on or anything when we recorded those songs, but they fitted just so well that it's so sweet to trust in Jesus. Mm-hmm. And how even back then when Elijah proved Him, and our story is that we have proved Him more and more. That's why we can sing that that hymn, that song that we've proved. We've proved God over and over and over again. And so, as Gavin said, look, if we can help you at all, that's exactly why we're here. So please send us a message, get in touch with us here on Facebook or on Instagram, or fire us an email to johnny.lennox@faithmission.org, or Amy is amy.lennox@faithmission.org.
Very original.
Get in touch with us, and we would love to hear from you if we can help you at all. If you've got questions, and like Gavin said, you know, you're wondering about God and you're maybe trying to figure it out, give us a shout and we would love to hear from you. We don't have all the answers, but we would love to hear from you. We would love to see if we can help you at all in some way, or maybe point you to somebody else who could. So get in touch if we can help. And
thank you so much to Gavin and to Timmy for sharing your skills and talents, and to Johnny, obviously, who was singing as well. Thank you so much to you all for leading us tonight and just blessing us.
Yeah, we so appreciate it, and we want to say thanks. Again, why not hit the share button or send it in a message to somebody. If you have enjoyed tonight, just, you know, share it in a message with somebody.
We almost doubled in views there after we said about hit and share, so it does
makes a difference. And we would love as many people to join in and to be blessed as well as we have. So thank you to you all who have made it to the end. Thank you to everybody who has watched through on the replay as well. And you know what, we'll probably be uploading this to YouTube. So if you're watching along on YouTube, then great to have you along as well. And we really appreciate you tuning in. Please then make a note of next month. When is it?
27th of May, Tuesday the 27th of May. And it's very exciting because we have, all the way from Canada, John and Isabel Bennett coming to. Isabel is sharing her story. She has an amazing life story, and Uncle John, who they're my uncle and aunt, Uncle John actually messaged me yesterday and said, Isabel's life story goes on for about 23 minutes. I don't have to do a talk if you don't want me to, but I'd want to do one.
Oh, we need a wee bit from John as well.
Yeah, so she has an amazing life story. I've heard it before, and I'm so looking forward to hearing it again, and John is going to be doing a wee epilogue as well. So please come along next month, share it, tell your friends, tell everybody, and join with us on the 27th of May.
Yeah, definite date for the diary. There'll be some music in there as well. Yeah. Just who that'll be.
Yeah.
Who knows? If you want to be part of it,
might be me.
Give us a shout.
Who knows?
Miracles would definitely have to be happening if you would ever agree to do that.
With my new hairstyle,
could do it, but you would never agree to do it.
No.
So if you've got musical talents and you would like to be involved, sure, fire us a message and we'll see what no pressure for just next month, maybe, but we'll get it figured out.
Yeah.
We have a few things in the pipeline as well, so we'll have something figured out for next month, the 27th.
27th
of May. And keep an eye on the page as well. We put out our Spark every Wednesday night. Mm-hmm. And we'll definitely have to get another week country gospel live stream in as well. I intended to look the diary and see when that might be.
Yeah.
I need to just pick a date and go for it.
Yeah.
It might not be a weekend, because weekends are getting busier now that things are opening up. So it might just be a wee midweek sing along. So we'll get one of those organized as well. And just there's the banger content. Feels like ages in a sense from banger. So if you want to just keep with us here at FM Transition and you missed any of the banger program, you can find it if you scroll back on Facebook or head over to our YouTube channel, and it's all in a playlist for you there. Just dead handy, all in a wee playlist. Hit subscribe when you're there, because the last I checked, we've 91 subscribers on YouTube. I'd love to break the 100.
Yeah.
I would love to get three digits in there. Mm-hmm. So if you haven't subscribed to our YouTube channel, you can subscribe to that as well when you're over.
And we probably have a bit of online camp news coming up in the near future.
Yeah, that'll be coming up as well.
Yeah.
Iris is asking, is that a Thursday? Is it the 25th, possibly?
No, it's Tuesday, Iris, so it could be.
It's definitely going to be a Tuesday. We might have got the date wrong. Let's just check.
It is the 25th. You're right, Iris.
There we go.
25th of May. Apologies.
Today's the 27th. That's what you've looked at.
That's what I'm looking. 25th of May.
The 25th of May.
Although if you turn up on the 27th, it will be uploaded on our page. So
better turning up in this case late, yes, for at least it will be there on replay. Yes. If you were to turn up 2 days early, then you wouldn't be getting anything.
At least some days a week.
So,
evening.
Yeah, the 25th of May.
Yeah.
The Tuesday, last Tuesday of the month.
Yeah.
Just get it recurring even in your diary, the last Tuesday of the month.
Because
we're planning to keep going. And just because things are opening up. Online has always been a part of what we do here at FM Transition, and we intend to keep it that way.
Mm-hmm.
So great to have you all on. Thanks so much
again
for tuning in. And sure, we'll see you again, for a spark or next month for the live stream.
Yeah.
So have a great night and a great week and a great month. We'll see you again soon.
Bye.